blessings of Lord Almighty. I request Ms. Rukmini Patil, student KSLU Law School, for the invocation song.
Jaya Jaya He Bhagavati Sura Bharati Tava Charana Pranamah Jaya Jaya He Bhagavati Sura Bharati Tava Charana Pranamah Hasina Bhava Manasa Hamse कुंद तुहिन शशिधवले हासीना भव मानस हमसे कुंद तुहिन शशिधवले हर जड़ताम पुरो बोधि विकासम सित पंकज तनु विमले जय जय हे भगवती सुर भारती तव चरणौ प्रणमामि ललित कलामयी ज्ञान विभामयी ललित कलामयी ज्ञान विभामयी वीणा पुस्तक धारिणी मथिरास्ताम्नो तव पद कमले वैकुंठा पुरवासिनी जय जय हे भगवती सुर भारती तव चरणौ प्रणमाम्यः जय जय हे भगवती सुर भारती जय जय हे भगवती सुर भारती जय जय हे भगवती सुर भारती तव चरणौ प्रणमामि.
थैंक यू रुक्मिणी, वी फील ब्लेस्ड इंडीड. May I request Professor Ratna R. Baramgowdar, Dean and Director, KSLU Law School, to kindly welcome the gathering. Please, ma'am.
A very good morning to one and all. Distinguished resource person for today's special lecture, Shri Shivyogi Kalsad, IAS, Managing Director, KSRTC, Bengaluru, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor P. Ishwar Bhatt, esteemed syndicate and academic council members, esteemed Sri Nitesh Patil, IAS, Deputy Commissioner Dharwad, Registrar Mr. Mohammed Zubair, KAS, Registrar Evaluation, Professor G.B. Patil, Professor C.S. Patil, former Dean, invitees, dear faculty members, and dear students. Karnataka State Law University was established in the year 2009 with the pious vision to provide quality legal education that is professionally competent and socially relevant. As a part of this design, various academic activities are formatted and the special lectures of the eminent personalities who are specialized in their areas are illustrations of such academic activities of the university. In fact, special lectures are crucial to strengthen and enhance the understanding of the depth of the subject. The topic for today's special lecture is Development versus Displacement, an overview of right to fair compensation and transparency in land acquisition and Resettlement and Rehabilitation Act 2013. To address on this topic, we have a very eminent resource person, Sri Shivyogi Kalsad, IAS, Managing Director, KSRTC Bengaluru. Sir, we immensely thank you for having spared your valuable time to address our students And we are extremely happy to have you as a resource person. On behalf of Karnataka State Law University, I extend a very warm and cordial welcome to you, sir. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. Namaskar.
I take this opportunity to cordially welcome Professor P. Ishwar Bhatt, Honorable Vice Chancellor, who is a tremendous source of inspiration for all the academic endeavors of the university. I extend a warm welcome to our esteemed syndicate and academic council members. A special welcome to esteemed Shri Mitesh Patil, IAS, Deputy Commissioner Dharwad, who has graced this occasion. A cordial welcome to our registrar, Mr. Mohammed Zubair, who has always been highly encouraging and supportive of all the activities of the university. I extend a hearty welcome to Professor G.B. Patil, Registrar Evaluation, Professor C.S. Patil, former Dean and Director of Law School. A warm welcome to Sri Gopalakrishna, IAS, Assistant Commissioner Dharwad, who has graced the occasion. I extend a hearty welcome to our faculty coordinators, Dr. Sunil Bagade and Sri Girish Kauda Patil. And last but not the least, it is a great delight for me to welcome all the invitees, principals and teachers from our affiliated law colleges, dear faculty members and dear students. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I also extend a hearty welcome to you, ma'am. I request Sri Mohammed Zubair N., Registrar, Karnataka State Law University, Hubballi, to kindly introduce the resource person. Please, sir.
Respected Vice Chancellor Sri P. Ishwar Bhatt, sir. Today's guest, respected Shivappa C. Kala, sir, IAS, MD, KSRTC, Registrar Evaluation, Professor G.B. Patil, sir. Dean and Director of our University, Professor Ratna Baramgowda, Madam, esteemed academic and syndicate members, senior and senior revenue officials, and even junior revenue official like Tashil Sir Jain, dear participants. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce Sri Shivayogi C. Kalasar. Sir is an alumni of Saini School, Vijapur. Sir has high academic record. He has done his B.Tech from NIT Suratkal. Sir is an executive MBA from Oxford University and University of Warwick, United Kingdom. After joining into service, sir is put in service for more than 24 years, performing various in a dozen capacities. Sir was served as a Deputy Commissioner Bijapur, served as a Regional Commissioner Belgaum Division, Bengaluru Division, and sir served as Secretary to Honorable CM. Being Managing Director Karnataka State Road Transport Corporation, sir has taken many IT initiatives. His proactive work during the pandemic situation will be remembered years to come. Sir has provided free access to transport the stranded migrants, and sir played a very key role in making mobile fever clinic on the wheels. So all in all, sir, the assignment to operational project as commissioner is so important and today is most relevant. After coming to effect, the new Land Acquisition Act on 1/1/2014, Karnataka is the first state to appoint commissioner for R&R. So for such a big responsibility to Sri Kalsa sir, this job is assigned. Sir has put his maximum effort to make success the third phase of Upper Krishna project. And sir has served in the transition period from old act to new act, right to fair compensation, transparency in land acquisition, resettlement rehabilitation act 2013. Sir, in fact, taken many initiatives in the Upper Krishna project, particularly in updating the record of rights. land to an extent of lakhs together were acquired and compensation was also paid, but that was not upgraded in the name of government. So sir has taken the initiative, built up a team, he done the work. I too feel proud being the part of that team for 2 years. So sir, in fact, is a very humble, simple man and very good listener. Sir is a singer, and more than that, sir is a very good human being. There is enough to tell about Sri Khalsa sir. Time is a constraint. So for us, it is a wonderful opportunity, particularly the student, to enlighten and enrich the knowledge in the land acquisition. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. I request Sri Shivayogi C. Kalsat, IAS, Managing Director, Karnataka State Road Transport Corporation, Bangalore, to deliver lecture on development versus displacement, an overview of right to fair compensation and transparency in Land Acquisition and Resettlement and Rehabilitation Act 2013. Please, sir.
Very good morning. Ellarigu namaskara, shubhodaya. Respected Professor Ishwar Bhatt, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Karnataka State Law University. Professor G.B. Patil, Registrar Evaluation. Professor Ratna Barmgowdaji, Dean and Director, KSLU. My friend Mohammed Jubesa, Registrar, KSLU. Honorable Syndicate and members of Academic Council. And my dear young friends, that is the student community of the large law university of the Karnataka state. I'm also told that some of the colleagues in the government, in the revenue department, have joined together to hear me out in this particular subject of land acquisition of 2013 Act. Well, friends, to begin with the law university, I must confess that I'm not a professor or a teacher like a very well known figure of educationists like Professor Bhatt or maybe Ratnaji. I'm a student of administration with hands-on experience of administering the laws, especially on the revenue laws, and more specifically on the land revenue, land acquisition, land reform laws, so and so forth. The present context of hearing this particular law, that is the new land acquisition of right to fair compensation and transparency in Land Acquisition and Resettlement and Rehabilitation Act of 2013. I was, as Mr. Jobair was mentioning, I was part of the transitionary provisions from the old act to the new act. Obviously, one has to understand the implications of this new act in the context of the old act of 1894. Just to take the listeners to a century ago, we were the part of the British India under the colonial rule, and whenever the colonial powers wanted any infrastructural development to be taken place at the behest of their interests, way back in 19th century, they had to perforce take possession of private land. Since there are not many legal provisions, they had to have a lot of problems en route. So they came out with the Colonial Act of 1894, Land Acquisition Act. 1894, my dear friends, this particular Colonial Act continued for a period of 119 years in our country. The same act also continues to exist in the other colonial ruled countries like Pakistan, Bangladesh, even Ceylon or the present day Sri Lanka, Burma. So you can assess the impact of this 1894 Act on the largest population of the world, which existed for more than a century. Obviously, it served the purpose of the colonial powers, but soon after we got independence. We continued with the traditions of the old act with a few amendments coming in the way in 1984 and a few more in the years to come. But what really was concerning the people of the country was that basically India is a country of farmers. The common man, they may not know the rules of law. Normally they believe that Sarkar is the be all and end all in the entire way of life, and they are entitled to take away the property. Hence, there was a kind of a issue related to the farmers. Late on, the ruling governments of the day tried to bring in various forms of amendment policies, etc. During the course of this particular century, you must remember as a student of law that earlier the land, the state obviously took away the land. Why? Because it had a belief in the principle of eminent domain, which basically means it's the right of the government of the day to expropriate any private land for that matter for public use. Kindly mark the word public use. Of course, by making some kind of a compensation payment. This was the eminent domain rule which existed over a centuries. However, this power of eminent domain came to be misused by the powers that be, and that caused a lot of heartburn. And obviously, various laws had to be introduced. My dear young students, obviously the Constitution of India, which is such a beautiful document, it mentions various articles. One of the articles, Article 246 of the 7th Schedule, says that various subjects can be introduced either in the union by the state or by both under the concurrent list. Under the list 2 of entry 45, the land, the subject of land, is entered as a state subject. That means state has the power to enact any law related to the land, including the land reforms, land revenue, land appropriation, etc. Under the list 3, under the entry number 42, the land acquisition, including the requisition of land, is covered under the concurrent list, which basically means that both the center as well as the state can enact laws related to the land in regard to the land acquisition and land requisition. That's why you have many laws related to the land acquisition. However, the Central Act remains one mother act called 1894 Act of Land Acquisition, followed by this particular Act of Right to Compensation of new Act of 2013. But this is not the only act. For example, as a student of law, Karnataka itself has brought in Karnataka's Land Acquisition Act, Karnataka Industrial Area Development Act, wherein you can acquire land for industrial purposes. Karnataka Housing Board Act, where you can acquire land for the development of housing sites. The Bangalore Development Act of 1976, where you can form layouts for the development of sites for distribution to the siteless persons. There is a Town and Country Act. Obviously, there are many such state enacted laws for specific purposes of utilization. However, the Mother Act still remains that 1894 Act, and some of the provisions of 1894 Act still continue to guide us through the process of 2013 Act. Well, you may ask whether the property which we all are owning, whether the state has the powers to acquire this particular land. What is the status of land? What about the private land? Is it a fundamental right or is it a constitutional right? Can anyone just acquire just because they require this particular land for a public purpose? Well, until 1978, that is the 44th amendment came into force, the right to property, which was then the fundamental right, it ceased to exist as fundamental right, and then it became a constitutional right, which basically means prima facie that private land can only be acquired by the state power by due process of law and by making a payment of just and fair compensation. This was the doctrine of compensation being given to the public in view of compulsory land acquisition. Because of this 1978 Act coming into force, the general public as such lost all the powers to bargain with the state, which was a huge establishment by itself. They could only take the claim to the legal recourse of higher compensation. Other than that, they did not have any other course of under the law. Until the 2013 Act came into force, the issue of rehabilitation and the resettlement, which was one of the major issues for the large population of the rural folk, it was just a policy. It did not have the teeth of the Act, which could be enforced in the court of law. Hence, this was what was required and what ultimately led to the process of consultation by eminent environmentalists. Various farmers' hesitation led to this kind of a thinking that the government has to do something more progressive than hitherto what it was being done over a century ago. You must have heard these and read about the famous cases of Tata Nano project in West Bengal, which moved from Nandigram to Gandhinagar in Gujarat, the famous project of POSCO, our own projects in Karnataka. Most of such infrastructure projects suffered because there was no involvement of the farmer community whose voice could be heard. There were no concerns regarding the rehabilitation or the resettlement issue. It was just a matter of payment of a paltry sum of compensation in a monetary compensation. That led to various other adverse impacts. The major issues, if I may say so, in the last 70 years, India itself has built such a huge infrastructure projects, be it the dams, or the roads, irrigation projects, railway projects, airports. Yes, these are all development needed projects. In the process of this particular development induced displacement, we have had almost 60 million displaced persons in this last 60 years or so. This is a huge human problem of resettlement of this 60 odd million people. 60 million is as good as the population of Karnataka state in the present day context. What happens with this particular displacement? What are the risks involved in this kind of displacement of such a huge population? One, they can get into the landlessness, joblessness. They can get into a homelessness scenario. The entire economic marginalization of the community can come into this particular issue. The food insecurity is another major issue, which can become a huge risk of displacement. Then, of course, the health sector, if you consider the increased morbidity of the people who gets displaced, what happens to the loss of access to the common property resources, be it the minor irrigation tank or the forest wealth or the road access? Some of the grazing lands, which normally we term it as a goma land in the villages, they all will be lost in the name of development. The community disarticulation can happen, which can ultimately lead to the education loss as well. Huge studies have happened by the World Bank and the ADB, which have made huge recommendations on this issue of or a debate of development versus displacement. While on the one hand, we want development, at the same time, we should be more humane and ensure that the displaced persons, their fate is not left to the mercy of God, and they are treated on par with the people who are ultimately benefited by this particular project. So that is the reason a lot of sociologists and anthropologists have gone into this whole issue of displacement. To quote an example, one Mr. Michel, Professor Michel Sarnia, who is a famous sociologist and anthropologist who worked for a number of years in the World Bank, he has worked out the displacement risks and come out with a policy of impoverishment of risks and reconstruction strategy. The words are used in the sociology context, and the effect of development causing the induced displacement is one of the major things which can cause a lot of heartburn. So he has put the cause of putting the people first in the whole context of displacement so that it becomes more humane, and we can, as a policy maker, as a law enforcer, as a law abiding citizen, we have to think that what are the mitigation of these risks. So with this whole context in the background, I may like to give some kind of a overview of the context as well as the new rule of law coming into force. So I'll just request my colleague to make the presentation. Yeah, please give the PPT. This is the just overview I would like to give. The students may be more interested in the sections. I think the professors, the deans may later on go into these sections later on. Yes. First of all, I would like to say why this whole new law came into force. I already mentioned the entire context under which it was made. Then is it the combined law of land acquisition and the rehabilitation and the resettlement being a combined law was the requirement of the present day? That is the context under which we are discussing. The scope of the present new law coming into force. Next would be what are the salient features of the whole entire new law coming into force, which includes various features like scope, the public purpose definitions, the urgency clause, the definition of affected families, etc., the compensation of land, the R&R entitlements, the involvement of Panchayat Raj institutions, and the role of the collector. I am told that some of the revenue officials and including the deputy commissioners are available. So what is the role of the collector? What is the present context under which we are discussing, etc.? They are covered under this particular law. Finally, the transparency provisions of law, the penalties, the awards, what are the timelines, what are the exempted legislations under the new act, and what is the flexibility being given to the states, etc. These are the kind of overview which I would like to just touch upon for about 40 minutes or so, followed by maybe the question and answers which the students can raise at a later point of time. Well, the new law, as I've said, was basically because the public concern was there, which heightened the issues of land acquisition. I've already mentioned the context of last 119 years. What happened? Hesitations of farmers coming into the public view of the distress of the farmers. So land, obviously, even in the present day context of the Indian society, a person is supposed to be rich if he has at least 10 acres of land, even if it is a dry land. A person is supposed to be called as a landlord in a village term. If you go back to the days of Mahabharata, when the whole issue of context of Kurukshetra war was about to happen, Lord Krishna appeared before the assembly of the Dhritarashtra. And as everybody is aware, he just requested for 5 villages. What is the present day Indraprastha in Delhi was what he probably asked for as a piece of land to avoid the whole Kurukshetra war. And we can all say even now, the land for which even the countries are fighting, states are fighting, families are fighting, brothers, kith and kin are fighting for the piece of land. So land continues to be a major social concern, even in the present day context. He may be a millionaire, he may be a billionaire, but he still, if he owns a piece of land, that particular legacy of passing on to the next kith and kin of land becomes very, very important. So the public concern regarding this heightened view of land acquisition was a major issue why this new land acquisition had to be forced into. Second was the 1894, which I have already mentioned, was an outdated law. Almost 119 years of Land Acquisition Act, which was originally helping only the powers that be, that is the colonial powers. So obviously, it had to address a need for balance was required. Concerns of farmers on the one hand, whose livelihoods were solely dependent on the land being acquired, and also to ensure that any welfare state had to provide for infrastructure, urbanization, industrialization, housing projects, transport projects. So that's why I think the need for balance was required. That is the reason why this whole new land acquisition law was required. Next. The earlier act of 1894 was solely an act to provide for compensation. It did not touch upon anything to do with rehabilitation and resettlement. Hence, there was a need for combining both the land acquisition as well as the R&R component within one law and ensure that the risk of neglect of R&R was reduced to a minimum. To be fair, this was the first national and central law on the rehabilitation and resettlement of families who were affected and displaced as a result of land acquisition. The scope, if I may summarize, both the land acquisition and the R&R provisions will apply when? Once, when the government acquires the land for its own use, hold and control. That is 100% it is using for its own purpose. Second, when the government acquires the land with ultimate purpose to transfer it for the purpose of private companies for a stated public purpose. For example, an industrial purpose, they would like to acquire the land for a Tata Birla company or an Infosys company. Hubli Dharwad also has a lot of companies there in the nearby contest. Thousands of land, acres of land has been acquired by Karnataka Industrial Area Development Act. In such a case, though it's a special act, the provisions of R&R will be applicable even in such cases. However, an exemption has been made to monetize the R&R components while giving the components of R&R facilities. That I'll come to it a bit later. And the third is when the government acquires the land for public-private partnership projects. Bangalore International Airport is a classic example of a public-private partnership. 49% stake was by government of Karnataka. 51 was by government of Karnataka. The remaining 49% was by different stakeholders, including the German superpower Siemens and other infrastructure projects. So when we acquire the land under the new act for such projects, then the various other provisions follow, which basically means a consent provision is required of 80% of the affected families is required if the land is acquired for the purpose of private companies or any stated public purpose. And thirdly, 70% of the affected family's consent is required if the land has been acquired for public-private partnership purposes. Then finally, no consent is required if it is purely for a public purpose. Mark my word, please. There's a difference between consent and consultation. Consent is required in regard to this 80% or 70%. However, consultation is a must in respect of all the three categories. This is the change. This is the process of consultation. What I see as a paradigm shift from the 1894 Act to 2013 Act. Now, we need to consult the public, be it the public Panchayat Raj institutions, or the affected people at large. Hence, the consultation process becomes very, very important. And finally, only R&R provisions will apply in cases of private companies who like to purchase directly for any project for an extent of land for a threshold limit which has been set up by the government for any such purpose. In our state, it is set as 100 acres of land. Some states have set it at 500 acres of land. That only means any private individual or a private company can directly purchase up to 100 acres of land without going into RNDAP provisions. It does not require any other monetary requirements to be fulfilled other than this. Next. The Act directly provides for some of the definitions. I would request the student community to go in depth of these particular definitions. The major thing is definition is what is the land for public purpose referring to? Public purpose referring to for strategic purpose, armed forces requirement, requirement of land for national security or defense, police, or even for the safety of the public, that could be a public purpose. The second most important thing is the land for infrastructure. Government of India has come out with various circulars, directives, as mentioned in the serial number 2127. The next is the land for the project affected people or the land for any planned development or improvement of village or for land required for persons residing in areas who are affected by natural calamities, etc. These are by and large a broad definition of what is meant by public purpose. Other than this, you cannot acquire the land other than the provisions of the mentioned as per the law. Earlier 1894 Act had the provisions of urgency clause, which was more than not, it was misutilized, misused or abused. That means the voice of the people whose lands were being acquired was hardly heard. The invocation of urgency clause was made more often than not as a matter of routine. Now, under the new act, this has been done away with. We can only get into the urgency clause of land acquisition in matters of just defense and security purposes. And number two, resettlement requirement of natural calamities of floods or earthquakes. Other than that, urgency clause cannot be invoked and you may have to go through the procedure of regular land acquisition. If there is a double displacement, there's an additional compensation of up to 75% compensation requires to be paid, etc. Next definition is regarding the affected families. It basically means the land owners and also the land livelihood losers. The earlier act provided for only the land owners whose names appeared in the revenue records who are entitled to get the compensation. The new act makes a different viewpoint of even the livelihood losers as the stakeholders. And who are these livelihood losers? It could be any tenant. It could be any coolie person in the sharecropper kind of a nature of a person whose livelihood is dependent on the landlord's land. Even such families, at least whose in livelihood was dependent for last previous 3 years, was considered as an affected family under this particular concept of new act. Next is regarding this next. The other salient feature was regarding the food security. Earlier act provided for acquisition indiscriminately of any land, including the irrigated land, for in the name of public purpose. Now, a safeguard has been provided by the under the new land act, which basically means the multi-crop irrigated land cannot be acquired. And if at all it has to be acquired, it has to be acquired only as a last demonstrable measure, saying that no other land was available and beyond a particular limit of which has been set by the government, you may have to go for dry land itself. You cannot acquire wet land or irrigated land which is producing food grains. So basically this is the security for under the Food Security Act, which you must be aware, two important acts came in the last 20 years. One was the Food Security Act, the other was the Right to Information Act. So the concerns of the farmers, the concerns of the country in regard to maintaining the food security was devolved into this particular new law, which ultimately was very important. The third thing is, in case of linear projects, example as highways, the railways, or the power lines, or the irrigation canals, this exception has been made of food security requirement. Next. The next important feature would be, what is the minimum compensation which guarantees a farmer by giving away or giving up his land? This is more important for our revenue officials or the land acquisition officers, which has been mentioned very elaborately in the first schedule of the new Land Acquisition Act. If I may add, the new act has 113 sections with 13 chapters and 4 schedules. 113 sections is not a much bigger one, something like your IPC, with 13 chapters and 4 schedules. The first schedule of this particular act gives the minimum compensation of land acquisition, which basically means the market value of the land. How the market value of the land is calculated is given in 1A and 1B, which is basically the minimum land value, which is already notified by the sub-registrar where the land is situated, or the average sale proceeds of such type of a land which is situated in that particular project area for the previous 3 years is taken into consideration. 50% of the sale deeds, which is of a higher order, that is the entire sale deeds are taken into consideration by excluding any such fictitious land record sale purchases, and the top 50% value is taken as one of the guidelines while calculating the compensation. And the higher of these two is taken as the base value. And to this is multiplied by a factor which varies from 1 to 2. This is called as a sliding factor. That comes in the next slide I'll give you. The sliding factor only gives you a kind of flexibility to the land acquisition officer to calculate the potential market value of the land. To this, you add the value of the assets, which includes the value of the building. It could be the trees, the wells, the crops, etc., which is valued by a professional government department authority. For example, it could be the PWD department, the horticulture department, or the agriculture department, which values these particular assets on the land. And finally, the total compensation is devolved into by adding these two. Now, to this particular total compensation, under the earlier act, there was a solatium component of 30% under the old act. The new act provides for 100% of the total compensation, which is a definite improvement of giving away for the kind of moral detachment or kind of value attached to this particular land. So this is what is called as a solatium, and 100% of that was added to this. So what ultimately comes is the valuation of the land. Added to that is a multiplication factor. To that you add the assets. The whole value what you get would be again added with 100% compensation. In the lay terms, it is now called as 1:4, though it is not exactly. So this way of calculation will ultimately lead to a calculation which will be 4 times the value of the guidance value, which is the value as on the date of preliminary notification. This is more important for the land acquisition officers to calculate. Next. This slide, of course, gives you the minimum compensation of slide of land for as an illustration for sliding scale. Multiplying factor goes from 1 to 2. If your land is situated from an urban pocket within a distance of, let's say, 10 kilometers, then it should be multiplied by 1. Beyond 1, it should be multiplied by 2. That is what the government of Karnataka has done. So in between, there's one more scale which has been given by Karnataka government, which means beyond the urban conglomeration, up to a range of 5 kilometers, it will be multiplied by 1.5. And beyond that,
it will be multiplied by 2. So the multiplying factor would be 1, 1.5 and 2. Though they are some of the other governments have done slightly more detailed multiplication factor. Now coming to the other comprehensive R&R packages, which is given in the second schedule of the Act. These are very, very welfare oriented monetary compensation, which is given over and above and in addition to the land acquisition compensation. This is being given not just to the landowner, but also some of the livelihood losers whose primary livelihood is lost due to the land acquisition. So the affected family obviously will be given the subsistence allowance of rupees 3,000 per month per family for a period of 12 months. And if the affected families are also entitled to, through a project, any mandatory employment, not necessarily a government employment, let me mark the words, any employment of any nature that could be given effective, or rupees 5 lakh rupees per family, or rupees 2,000 rupees per month per family as an annuity scheme for a period of 20 years with appropriate indexation of inflation. So this is the minimum entitlement what is available for the affected family. And if a house is lost in a rural areas, then he's also eligible for a constructed house based on the, some of the specifications of government program of Indira Awas Yojana of 50 square meters. And likewise in the urban area also, he's eligible for a similar such benefits. Then for a transportation monetary compensation of 50,000 rupees is being given. A one-time resettlement allowance of 50,000 is being given. Likewise, as you see next, there are some special safeguards and provisions for scheduled castes and scheduled tribes. In the most general cases, you may see the lands of poor people, the depressed classes, the scheduled castes, scheduled tribe people who hardly have any voice to be heard in the context of acquisition is being acquired. And that ultimately leads to the risks of livelihood. So in addition to these packages, what was already dwelt into earlier, these are the addition the SCST families will be given. That means land will be given to each family in every project, even in case of irrigation projects. These are the additional projects. However, a caveat is, if land is not available, then other measures of monetary compensation can be given. One-time financial assistance of rupees 50,000. Families who are settled outside the district will be entitled to an additional benefit of 25%. Payment of one-third of the compensation amount at the beginning, at the outset itself. Preference in relocation and resettlement in the area in the same compact block. Obviously, in the village community, the society, religion, caste factors a lot even now. So as far as possible, a compact block to ensure that their ethnicity, their unified customs and culture is maintained, then preference has to be given. Free land for community and social gatherings. In case of displacement, a development plan has to be made, etc. And continuation of reservation and other benefits which are covered under Schedule 5 and Schedule 6 areas for the benefits from the displaced area to the resettlement area. What is Schedule 5 and Schedule 6? Schedule 5 refers to basically 10 tribal states of our country, which are not part of the northeastern states of Assam, Nagaland, etc. So basically it refers to Chhattisgarh, Odisha, these kind of states which have the tribal context and they are covered under Schedule 5. Schedule 6 covers the northeastern states which have even the autonomous districts which will be covered under the Schedule 6. So all such reservation benefits which are covered under Schedule 5 and Schedule 6, those benefits will continue for these people or these classes of people. Next. Other feature would be obviously there's an enhanced role of Panchayat Raj institutions now. Unlike the previous regime of 1894, Now the role of Gram Sabhas, the consultation with the Panchayat Raj institutions is very much a part of the entire process of land acquisition. The new concept of social impact assessment has come into force. This is basically a sociology term, which is basically a tool to predict the kind of adverse impacts which is likely to be caused due to the forced land acquisition on the part of the farmers. So if an impact assessment study has been done in advance, and if these impact assessment studies along with the mitigation measures is taken into consideration in consultation with the Panchayat Raj institutions, in consultation with the people who are affected, and by having consultation in the Gram Sabha, that becomes a more of a public opinion, more of a transparency comes into the whole process of consultation process, which was obviously missing in the old act. The new act provides that kind of a new paradigm shift from the old act to the new act. Next. Next will be regarding the acquisition. Only if it is required and necessary, only it has to be done. There could be no indiscriminate land acquisition. Enhanced compensation is available now, unlike what it was earlier. There are strict restrictions on multi-crop acquisition. There is a consent, prior consent requisition by the process of law. All these are by law, they are provided under the new act. So the role of the collector in this particular case stands reduced, unlike the previous act. Under the old act, he was the Maharaja or Raja to acquire any piece of land by quoting the public cost. Now, the role of the collector or the role of the land acquisition officer is predefined. He has to follow this process of law, by due process of law. Otherwise, the legal process can always kick in, and the affected party can always get the redress done. Next. Certain safeguards have also been provided to the farmers in terms of damages to the crops which has been done, or by way of a share in the developed land, or by way of a fishing rights given, by way of a traditional rights which has been given, etc. This, of course, is done at the village level. Next. The third schedule. Okay. You may be keen to know that once the land gets acquired, especially in cases where the rehabilitation is required to be done in a new area or in a new settlement, in such cases, there are certain amenities which need to be provided in the resettlement area, which are basic requirements. For example, schools, health centers, roads, electric connections, drinking water facilities, panchayat ghats, the Anganwadis, or places of worship, places of burial, post office, etc., the fair price shops. These are all required basic amenities which is now taken as assured. They need to be provided so that the context of land being acquired from a person, his situation is supposed to improve rather than deteriorate. That is why it is called as more humane. If you go through the preamble of the act itself, it says it's a more humane, more transparent, more public consultative, etc., unlike the old act. So all these are the salient features which provides for the new act under the 2013 act. Some of the very interesting sections or clauses, just like to mention a couple of them, I'll take a couple of minutes into this. It has a retrospective operation effect, which basically means under the old act, which was existing up to 31/12/2013, the new act came into force on the 1st January 2014. So the transition powers provisions are something like this, where no award was passed under the old act, then the new law will apply with regard to the compensation. Secondly, where an award has already been made under the old act, But the affected individuals have not accepted the compensation or have not yet given up the possession. And the proceedings have been pending for 5 years or more. In such a case, the provisions of the new law will apply. Thirdly, where a majority of individuals in an affected area have not received the compensation under the old act, then the new law will apply. This is a very interesting continuation of this would be section 24(2). The law students could kindly make note of this particular section. Section 24, subsection 2 is one of the most litigant sections in the history of Land Acquisition Act under the new rule. It only has a mention of vitiation or the lapsing of the proceedings of the entire land acquisition proceedings of the old act if certain provisions of effect of new land acquisition have not been brought into force. So section 24 subsection 2 is a very important subsection which has reached this Honorable Supreme Court, and the Constitutional Bench of the Honorable Supreme Court has very recently passed a judgment dated 6th of March 2020. And it is a reportable ruling by Supreme Court over a number of other state high court judgments, etc. That itself makes a separate study by itself. So I would not go much deep into that particular provision. It is basically a non-obstant clause which has an overriding effect of any other legal provisions of being lapsed provisions, etc. I would request the dean to later on take a subject on that itself. Then, of course, the feature would be the compliance with other laws regarding the Panchayat extension to the Scheduled Areas Act. It will be fully compliant with this particular act. It should be compliant with the Scheduled Tribes and other Traditional Forest Dwellers Act. It should be compliant with the Land Transfer Regulation Act, et cetera, et cetera. These are all basically referring to the central laws. Now, coming to the process itself, I think the land acquisition officers or the revenue officials in the field would be more keen to know more about this. I've just given the process flow, how the process of land acquisition has to be initiated by the intending authority. So initially the proposal is received by the appropriate government, be it the state government or even the central government. Then the pre-notification stage of social impact assessment is conducted by the appropriate government. Then the legitimacy of public purpose and the social impact assessment is examined and approved by the government. And all this is the pre-notification stage. Once this is done, the next stage comes to the actual notification part of it. That is, publication of preliminary notification to acquire under Section 11 of the new Act. Earlier, it was called as Section 4 of old Land Acquisition Act. Section 4 to Section 9 under the Chapter 2 of the new Act refers to the social impact assessment, public hearing, publication, appraisal by the expert group. These are the processes involved in the entire process of pre-notification stages. The notification stage includes the publication of preliminary notification to acquire, the public hearing, the draft declaration, and the R&R scheme has to be published, and the R&R award has to be finalized. After that, the finalization of R&R scheme has to be done by the competent authority. This has been given in Chapter 4 of the new Act, wide Section 11, Section 19, and Section 23 of the new Land Acquisition Act. Next. Then there are certain institutional structures which is given. For example, at the central level, Government of India, there's a National Monitoring Committee which oversees at the central level all the projects. Likewise, in the state level, there is a State Land Acquisition Rehabilitation Resettlement Authority. Then at the project itself, level itself, there is a committee which is constituted by the appropriate government for which the deputy commissioner or the additional deputy commissioner will be heading that particular committee at the district level. At the state level, it will be the state commissioner for R&R who will be monitoring and who will be heading this particular committee as an overall administrator for the state. And at the project level, there's the district collector, there's an administrator, then there is a R&R committee. All this is part and parcel of the institutional mechanism which oversees the implementation of the new act at the field level. This comes with the timelines also. Chapter 7 of Section 48, Section 50 gives the timelines for these activities which has been mentioned in this particular institutional methodology. Next. I've already mentioned regarding the safeguards against the indiscriminate acquisition, which basically was included as part of a more safeguards under the provisions of the new act against indiscriminate acquisition, which refers to the social impact assessment, which is now made mandatory. Of course, it comes with a recent amendment, which has made an exemption under Rule 10. So other than that, under the old provisions of the new act itself, this was made mandatory. Draft notification, what is the requirement? The draft declaration, the land ownership requirements of change of land use, etc. All these are part and parcel of certain safeguards which has been mentioned under the new act. Next. Then there's transparency provisions. Transparency includes consultation processes of Gram Sabha, summary notification requirements, documentation of the social impact assessment, which is meant for public scrutiny. It has to be given in the website of a particular project area. R&R scheme has to be published. Draft notification has to be made available for public scrutiny, followed by individual awards for R&R, and also a public disclosure can also be made available under this particular new act. Next. Then there are, of course, some stringent comprehensive penalties which are mentioned under the new regime for companies and the government. There is a strict punishment clause for false information with any malified intention. It could be by institution or it could be by the farmers themselves. By giving any false information, they are liable for any penalty which is available under the provision of law. The timelines is given under Section 23 of the new Act. Collector has to pass two types of awards. One, the land acquisition award has to be passed as per requirement under the first schedule. Number two, land acquisition, besides that, there should be an award for R&R. That means the R&R entitlements which are listed under the second schedule has also to be passed. So these timelines have to be followed. Next. And the compensation has to be given previous. The compensation has to be given within a period of 3 months from the date of award. This comes with the mandatory clause of 3 months. Otherwise, the interest liability can go up. The monetary R&R entitlements will have to be provided within a period of 6 months from the date of the award. Infrastructure entitlements will be provided within a period of 18 months from the date of award. Then there is no involuntary displacement that will take place without the completion of R&R. And in respect of irrigation or hydel projects, R&R shall be completed 6 months prior to the submergence. So these are the timelines which act like safeguards against indiscriminate acquisition, indiscriminate eviction. These are the humane nature of land acquisition new law which has come into force. Next. What is the impact of this particular law on the existing law of the Government of India as on 1/1/14? As I've mentioned, the cutoff date was 1/1/14, which was the effective date of the new act coming into force. By then, there were 13 central acts which were existing as on that date under the Land Acquisition Act, which includes, for example, National Highway Act, your Hubli-Dharwad BRTS project, dear friends, was acquired under the National Highway Authority Act. The Hubli-Pune Highway, Hubli-Bangalore Highway, all these highway projects were acquired under the National Highway Authority Act of 1956. This act was one of the 13 acts under the Central Government Act, which was included under Schedule 4 of the Act. You can refer to the Schedule 4. There are 13 acts mentioned. And this particular law gave an exemption of 1 year from 1114 up to 1115 or 3112-14 as an exemption to enforce this particular law. Now, after 1115, this law has become mandatory in terms of payment of compensation, in terms of payment of R&R entitlements, either physical assets being provided or by way of giving monetized benefits under the R&R entitlements. So this is mandatory after 1115, even under these 13 acts which have come into force. Next. Some of the flexibility has been given to the states. As I've mentioned during my earlier briefing itself, states can evolve their own rules into this particular act. Section 109 of the act provides for the state to come out with their own rules. Rules are basically subsidiary to the act. Act is supreme. Rules come next, obviously. Then comes the regulations or the notifications beyond that. So the states have the power to evolve a sliding scale on the basis of which a compensation can be given from a sliding factor 1 to sliding factor 2. Our state has come up with 1, 1.5, 2. Some of the states have given just 1, 1.5 itself, not even 2. So it all depends on the kind of valuation which the particular state government has done it earlier. Then the state can also have flexibility to fix the threshold limits for multi-crop irrigated lands. In state of Karnataka, it is now 100 acres in a particular district. Likewise, threshold limit for which R&R provisions will apply for a private purchase itself also is 100 acres. States are now encouraged to adopt the option of lease instead of acquisition. And states are also empowered by this law to provide for benefits and safeguards that are well over and above these provisions what are being given under this law, which basically means these are the basic minimum entitlements which the law provides for. But it is left to the state governments, respective state governments, to go beyond this. If some state wants to go and give 1:6 times, they are more than willing to, welcome to provide that kind of benefits to these particular persons. The examples of some of the states has been quite good. Whereas some of the states have found it very difficult to implement even this new law, which has come into force from 1114. Why this procedure has become so laborious in some case, if you can call it so, is these provisions are acting more like safeguards. They're putting the people first, unlike in the past where the state was put in the center, the public purpose was put in the center and others were all subsidiary. Now, the interest of the public or the person whose land or asset is being acquired, his interests are put at the center of the place. Hence, it is now made slightly more, I would say, procedural, slightly more complicated, more transparent, more public opinionated before we actually go for land acquisition. Some of the major examples of land acquisition in Karnataka state, just to quote an example, are the irrigation projects in Upper Krishna project, Ghataprabha, Malaprabha projects, the Kaveri belt projects, they're all irrigation projects. Bangalore, if you take, it's a metro rail projects. The land is acquired under the Karnataka Industrial Area Development Project, KIADP Act, as a special project. The National Highway Authority Act, they also acquired land. These are some of the major projects which the state of Karnataka is taking this. However, as a student of law, you have to be in touch with the central law the applicable laws which are applicable to a specific state or any other state for that matter, which will really take the land acquisition to its logical conclusion. Karnataka has come out with the rules, Karnataka State Land Acquisition Rules of 2015. The notification for this was issued on 17th October 2015, White Gazette dated on Part 4A, it has already been mentioned. Now coming to the actual implementation part of it, there were a lot of challenges while implementing that, because the public opinion had to be generated, the mandatory declarations had to be done. All this was again going back to the debate of development versus displacement issue again came to the fore. The government, some of the governments took to the route of amending this act also by inserting provisions of Section 10A, which basically tried to dilute the provisions of the 2013 Act by exempting the requirement of social impact assessment, by exempting the requirement of consent provisions, and by inserting the provision of direct purchase of land if required. All these provisions were made taking into consideration the field level situation of acquiring the land for a public purpose, whereas keeping in mind the overall concept of the adverse impact of development-induced displacement for the families who get affected. So now you see a paradigm shift from the old act, where the farmer used to get a pittance, but now farmer is able to manage to get an adequate and fair compensation for his land being acquired. Of course, he may not be satisfied even with this compensation. He has an appeal provisions in the district, which a special authority has been constituted. He can appeal and get and hesitate and get a fair compensation even at the district level court also. Even at the district court, if he is not satisfied, he can, by way of a writ, he can file an appeal in the high court. High courts have come to his help by enhancing the compensation even at that point of time also. So friends, some of these issues which I have mentioned were basically regarding the Land Acquisition Act of 1894, concerning and transitionary powers, and the 2013 Act. Some of the provisions which I have mentioned may ultimately lead to further litigation. Section 24, which I have mentioned, may enter into further litigation. The district court compensation, which has been awarding the higher compensation, again, that might have a lot of litigation issues. And finally, even the courts have evolved a kind of a Lok Adalat concept, wherein the public and the authorities who are acquiring the land are facing each other across the table and entering into direct dialogue and try to resolve these issues as a dispute redressal mechanism and sort of the long-standing litigation which is available for the people at large. So friends, this at large, I must say and conclude, finally saying that the new act has made a big impact by having a paradigm shift from the colonial-based opinionated Land Acquisition Act to a people-centric, farmer-centric, development-centric kind of a law, which in a way helps not just the farmer, but also helps the development of a project in the larger context of the whole development of the country as a whole. I think it's a win-win situation, not just for the government, but also for the farmer to make use of these provisions under the new Land Acquisition Act. We may come across many legal amendments, law amendments in the days to come, but I'm sure the interpretation will continue to dwell in the annals of history of legal terminology of high courts and the Honorable Supreme Court. But finally, the law is for the people of the land. It is for the public, and the state government has to use this law with abundant caution, with care, and with a humane approach for the public at large. Thank you, one and all. I'm open for further questions if there are any. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you so much, sir, for an enlightening and a thought-provoking lecture. May I request Dr. Sunil N. Bagade, Assistant Professor.
Ramya, 1 minute.
Yes.
Students have any queries, clarification, you can ask to sir.
Sir, as of now, no questions have been posed by the students.
Sir, I have little doubt, sir.
Please.
Students have no question. One just a clarification from sir. Sir, for me, KDB was assigned for a few months, sir, in Dharwad. When we are going for consent award, we were attracting the new Act Section 26 while arriving the compensation. If farmers say no for the consent, again, we are going back to the old Act, wherein just average taking the market value for the last 3 years, then giving 30% solatium and 12% interest from the date of notification to award, sir. So in the new Act says, Section 114, that Land Acquisition Act 1894 is hereby repealed. So that I written letter to KDB board also, not got any clarification. So that is one doubt, sir, from me, sir.
In fact, a very important question has been raised by a colleague. No questions from a student means they have understood everything. They are now experts in the Land Acquisition Act. So let us hope so. But actually, the problems and the doubts arise only when you start reading and when you start understanding and when you start administering the act at the field level. So as Mr. Jubair Saab has mentioned, Karnataka Industrial Area Development Act, KIADB Act, is a special enactment by the state government of Karnataka, which basically is an act to develop the land for industrial purposes and handing it over to the prospective industrialists or a small-scale industrialist. It is a small act, and the provisions of land acquisition is only a small three sections as an entire part of the KIADB Act. The Mother Act of 1894 was part of the KIADB Act, which basically meant that KIADB can enter into an agreement for purchase of land. So you could have gone into an agreement under the old act also. Then the rates were finalized, and those rates were finalized in the particular committee and ratified in your board. And the same could be treated as part and parcel of your award under the 1894 Act also. Section 11 of the 1894 Act was taken directly as part of the KIADB Act for the purposes of land compensation. All other provisions of the law were specific to the KIADB in terms of regulation, in terms of development of the land, etc., purchase of site, sital value, etc. They were part and parcel of other matters. But regarding the KIADB Act itself, many people challenged it before the High Court. There are multiple levels of challenges, single bench, double bench. It went up to the Supreme Court also, even as late as yesterday also. In fact, the CEO and the principal ACS, additional chief secretary, industry department called up yesterday. The case is coming up again tomorrow. There's no finality to this particular whole issue of KIADB Act, whether the compensation part of it can be or is it a must under the provisions of the new act. What now is understood is the provisions of the new Land Acquisition Act of 2013 regarding compensation, monetary compensation and monetary R&R entitlements will be made applicable to the KIADB Act. That is the meaning. If at all they don't agree to these entitlements, then by force you may have to go by Section 26 of this particular entitlements, etc. He may agree or he may not agree. Then there is always a provision to appeal for higher compensation. Unlike the old Act, where there was an agreement of price fixing also, but now even if there is a disagreement on the part of the farmer and the KIADB, then you will have to by force go for compulsory acquisition. Again, the provisions of eminent domain will come into picture even now also. But being a special act, the applicability of the special new Land Acquisition Act of 2013, applicability of this act to the KIADB Act is very, very limited in regard to the compensation part of it. Regarding the procedure part of it, it is not bound by this new act. KIADB procedure is slightly different. The procedure of SIA, R&R under the new act is totally different. So you have to make a differentiation between the procedure as enunciated on the 2013 Act and the KIADB Act. However, the nature of compensation, the entitlements of R&R should be minimum, at least as much as provided under Schedule 1, 2, 3 of the 2013 Act. If that is followed, I think KIADB should not have a problem.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. There are two questions raised by the students. With the approval of the resource person, I would like to bring to the notice of the resource person the questions raised by the students. The first question is, in relation to certain commercial property, sometimes government acquires part of the commercial property and leaves other part with the owner. And at the time of computation of the compensation, only the part acquired, for that the compensation is computed, whereas for the rest of the part, the compensation is not paid. The question is, the remaining part which is left with the owner, that loses value because of the other part is acquired, and for that no compensation is paid. With respect to that, the person wants to know the opinions.
Yes, it's a very pertinent question. Part of the property or asset is being acquired, making the other part as being totally ineffective in terms of their income generation or for their livelihood purpose also. In such a case, number one, if the majority of the asset is being acquired, then it is left to the land acquisition authority to acquire the whole property. Or if he feels that the whole property acquisition may not be required and the remaining part can still be utilized, however, his livelihood or his asset valuation comes down, then he has to pay for damages in addition to the land compensation which is being acquired. So that comes as a part of your compensation, which is added to the damages, ex gratia, the solatium, etc. This is part and parcel of all these issues of compensating a person whose land becomes unfruitful, unutilized, or losing the value for the acquiring the portion of the land which is more profitable, more asset generating kind of thing. So he's definitely eligible for that kind of a compensation.
Okay, thank you, sir. The second question is, acquisition of the land involves forced mass displacement sometimes. During that point of time, not only the socio-economic fabric of the people who have been displaced, that gets affected, even environment gets affected because of the displacement and the projects which the government implements. In the background of this, how government tackles the issue of balancing rights of the people and protection of environment with that of the development?
Very interesting question again. Unlike the old act of 1894, the new act has come out with a mandated requirement of social impact assessment. The social impact assessment, as a student of sociology, they would know that it is not restricted to an individual or an individual community. It is a society at large or even an environment at large. So it could be a social impact assessment studies will have to be done. The impacts could be societal in nature. It could be environmental in nature. For example, as you have assessed it, it could be air pollution could be there because of industry coming in play. Noise pollution could be there because of a railway project coming in there. Or it could be a water pollution of the common public properties being maybe totally violated in terms of the cleanliness in terms of poisonous gases coming into place, etc., etc. All these are part and parcel of environmental impacts. And it is mandated again under Section 6 of this particular Act, which states that all the environmental impact assessment study will have to be taken into consideration, and its adverse impact studies plus the mitigation factors, as you have assessed, what are the mitigation factors? Supposing, let us say, a project is coming in and it is going to be proving to be a major problem for the water project there. For example, a small lake could be there, etc. In such a case, what are the mitigation effects? Whether the project can be displaced, whether the, for example, road linear project going across the entire forest area for that matter, can it be taken a detour, or the forest trees will have to be cut? What are the pollution levels? So there will be different strategies to reduce the environmental impacts. Obviously, there could be a situation where you can go for either doing away with the project itself or striking a balance between trying to mitigate the social and environmental impacts to the minimum possible, so that the benefits accrual to the society at large far outweighs than the cost which is being now imposed on an individual or a society or the concerned community at large. So I think that should be a real concern for the expert committee which goes into this whole project of being beneficial to the society based on the SIA studies. The appraisal committee goes into this. The appraisal committee will have experts from the academics, from the industry, from the environmental industry, from the pollution control board, or from any other land requiring authority based expert. They definitely have an authority to go into this whole subject and suggest mitigation factors. And it's up to the government to adopt this particular study and implement the mitigation factors also. And if the mitigation factors cannot be implemented, if the adverse impacts are far outweighing than the benefits, then the whole project can be shelved. They may say this is not worthwhile because it is causing huge environmental cost to the society, to the community. It may not be worthwhile. So they may give a negative report. So you may not proceed with the land acquisition itself at that stage itself. So that is what has comes as a major relief to the society as well as the community. Now they have a voice now, unlike under the previous Act.
Thank you, sir. With the permission of resource person, we would like to take one more question. The question is with respect to 2013 Act. The objective of 2013 Act is to balance between development and fair compensation. The student intends to know how far the state government has achieved this objective in ensuring development and at the same time making a way for payment of fair compensation to those displaced. Sir, please.
Yeah. The development versus displacement issue, as I've said, will continue to raise in even with this new Act also. We cannot take away this debate just because the new Act has come out with a far better humane approach. We cannot take away that debate. It will continue to be there. However, regarding the compensation part, I can definitely say that the relief measures, the monetary compensation, which has been now being made available under the provisions of 2013 Act, is definitely far better in terms of the content, in terms of the whole extent of community requirements, etc., when compared to the 1894 Act. Definitely, it's much more benevolent Act, unlike the 1894 Act. But you ask me whether the displacement persons are happy with this kind of a monetary relief, I can say with the word of caution, saying that no person whose land or asset has been acquired will be ever happy, even if you give him 1 crore rupees for 1 acre of land. That is a human instinct. Nobody would like to lose a piece of his hereditary land, which is his forefather's land, which he has earned by hard toil and blood, etc., and sweat. Obviously, he would like to get that land into his family's culture. So he would not definitely be happy. But yes, compared to 1894, the governments of the day have been more than willing to give more monetary compensation, unlike 1894. To that extent, I must say that he's slightly better off than the earlier version of 1894 Act.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for answering to the questions of the students. Thank you, sir. Ramya, please take over the session.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir. May I request Dr. Sunil Gadi, Assistant Professor, KSLU's Law School, to kindly deliver the vote of thanks. Please, sir.
Thank you, Ramya. Honorable Vice Chancellor, respected dignitaries, distinguished resource person, Sri Shivayogi Kalsar, IAS, MD KSRTC Bengaluru, Sri Nitesh Patil, IAS Deputy Commissioner, Dharwad, invitees, syndicate and academic council members, statutory officers of the university, staff and students of law school, participants. Good afternoon to all. It gives me an immense pleasure to propose vote of thanks on this important occasion. On behalf of Karnataka State Law University, invitees and participants, I wholeheartedly thank distinguished resource person Sri Shivayogi Kalsar, IAS, MD, KSRTC, for delivering thought-provoking lecture on development versus displacement, an overview of right to fair compensation and transparency in land acquisition, resettlement, and Rehabilitation Act of 2013. Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful lecture. Thank you.
Thank you. It's my pleasure.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I express my gratitude to Sri Nitesh Patil, IAS Deputy Commissioner, Dharwad, for sparing his valuable time and gracing the occasion. Thank you, sir. I express my sincere thanks to Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. P. Ishwar Bhatt, for encouraging us in organizing this lecture. Thank you, sir. I owe my gratitude to Mohammad Zubair, NKS Registrar, for his support and guidance in organizing this lecture. Thank you, sir. I thank Professor Dr. Ratna R. Bharangodar, Dean and Director of KSLU's Law School, Professor Dr. G.B. Patil, Registrar Evaluation, Professor Dr. C.S. Patil, Professor, for their support in organizing this event. Thank you. I thank the members of Syndicate, Academic Council, staff and students of Law School, participants for their participation. Thank you. I thank the organizers for providing this opportunity. Thank you all. Thank you.
Before closing, let me again thank the Karnataka Law University. It has been my privilege to be part of this kind of a discussion, which is thought-provoking. It also gives us as the administrator to know what the law students aspire for, what their books actually are being taught. Unlike we, the administrators being in the field, we may try to reconnect from the university to the field. So that provision has been made by the university professors, and I thank the Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Patil, Dr. Ratna, and of course, Dr. Mr. Jobair, and all other colleagues on the panel. I hope the students have been made use of at least to some extent. And if there is a recording to that, kindly share with the other students as well. So that is my privilege to be part of this kind of discussion. And on behalf of Government of Karnataka, I thank the university and all other colleagues on the board itself. Thank you very much and good day. Namaskar.
Thank you, sir.
That was an excellent presentation, sir. And our students have been immensely benefited. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Blended with the theory and, you know, practice. Letter of law and spirit of law. How it
and
is
with excellent oratory skills, sir.
It was really, you know, eye-opener. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you. Shall we adjourn, ma'am?
Yes, we can wind up this meeting.
Yes, ma'am. We adjourn for the day.
Thank you. Thank you all.
I wish everyone a good day. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.